Hi guys, so I'm back again and I just want to, you know, thank you guys for really taking your time to watch that 25 minutes video I posted last week, and I just say thank you, not because of you guys really did anything, to be honest, it's just God's word, you know, spreading, but just because you guys actually took time out to watch the 25 minutes video. Because when I watched it, I realized that, like, at the beginning I was very scared, then at the end it was like, ooh, Holy Spirit took over. So I was really glad that you guys didn't miss out on, you know, what the Holy Spirit had to say. And yeah, I just pray that God keeps on blessing you guys, and just He shall keep on strengthening you guys in your walk with Christ. Today I'll be talking to you guys about, you know, a godly mind and the battles in the mind of a young Christian in this day and age. And just before I start, I would like to pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for just waking us up to see this wonderful day. I just ask that even as I speak about what you've put in my heart, Lord Jesus, give me the right words to say. Speak through me. Let me not speak according to my own knowledge, but under the unction of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray.
Yes.
Amen. A godly mind. Funny enough, like, this is something that I've been struggling with for a while now, and I think on Wednesday or Thursday, I can't remember, I was doing my devotion, and, you know, God just puts it in my hands, like, memorize Romans 12, 1-2, memorize it. And, like, I memorized it and everything, and when I memorized it, I feel like, you know, there was clarity in the word, and something just said, you just have to speak about, you know, a godly mind. This is what a lot of young Christians struggle with now, and they are really afraid to say it because of the way the world seems. It's like, oh, you'll be condemned. My sister, you will not be condemned, because if you're struggling with something, you have to let loose of it to grow. And, you know, I'm just here to encourage you guys as usual, and to, you know, give you guys maybe like tips or something that I used to fight this battle. Yeah, you have to fight the battle by yourself. You have to read your word, but, you know, encouragement is useful. And I always talk about that this Christian race is actually not, it's not easy, to be honest. Like, I'm not even gonna lie, it's not easy, and we need, like, people around us to help us, to encourage us, to pray for us. And, you know, I've just volunteered myself to do that for you guys. So just pray the Lord helps me and strengthens me, and He should just keep on filling me even as I give to you guys what He's giving me. Yeah, amen. So I was just thinking, and when I was, like, writing my notes down, I got this, and it said, like, our imagination, like, what we think about really forms the kind of human beings we are. It forms our relationship with God. Like, it's the basis, like, the battle of the mind is what really determines whether we go to heaven or not. Now, well, let me explain what I mean by that, in the sense that if you battle a lot with maybe lust or pornography, or, you know, fear of death or something in your mind, it's if you really want to break out of it, it's the zeal to break out of it that gives you the strength to persevere in your Christian race, and it helps you to grow stronger. Like, I know, I think somebody once said something like, we can't really stop some thoughts from coming to us, because, to be honest, like, the devil is always there to attack, but it is how you fight it, how you fight the devil, that will determine how serious you are on this journey with Christ. And I think that's what we need to, like, know as young Christians, because don't think that, oh, because I'm thinking about this, I'm thinking about that, I'm going to hell and everything. No. We now need to work on ourselves, like, what should I do so that I can stop this thought? What should I do so I can stop this, you know, imaginations from creeping into my head? And what came to my mind first was filter your mind. And I was like, what do you mean by filter your mind? Like, what's filter your mind? And clarity as to filter your mind came from Romans 12, 1. Romans 12, 1 and 2. And it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And I already was like, you know what, we have, there's this misconception as to the fact that I've not had sex, I've not done anything with my body, hence I'm clean, I'm a virgin, you know, I'm walking the right path. But I'm sorry to bust your bubble. The way I see these verses speaking right now is your body needs to be a reasonable service. However, your mind should not be conformed to the world. And that's where the devil tries to creep into our minds and make us fear. Like, for example, as a young lady, a young Christian lady, I might not be having sex. Doesn't mean I'm not thinking about sex. And the devil will come and be like, you think you're smart. And it's funny because a lot of us, we actually haven't had sex, or, you know, we haven't done some things. Like, we haven't really killed somebody, but in our minds, like, we've shot people dead. We've stabbed people. Together, we've basically, like, and the devil tries to come and creep into our minds. And what I got from Romans 12, 2 was, like, we should not be conformed to the world, but we should renew our mind. And I was like, what does the Bible mean by renew? And renew basically means, I think, renew, make something new, like over again. It's a continuous thing. So it's not like I renew my mind today, that's all. It means it's a constant cycle. Renew, renew, renew. Remember, I came back something that I used to say when we were children. An idle mind is the devil's workshop. Like, I believe that thing in my life. I'm not even joking. Sometimes I'll be in my bed, I'm not doing anything, I'm just like maybe watching TV. The devil will just bring one thought into my head. I'll be scared. And all those thoughts can cause self-condemnation. And you'll be like, oh, I've done, since I've thought about this, or since I've, you know, since my mind is unclean, how can I go to God? And God doesn't really like that banter. It doesn't impress him. God just wants you to come, let him clean you. God is not asking for you to wash yourself before you come to him, because if you wash yourself, you will actually never be perfect to come to God. But God is like, come as you are, however dirty you are, I don't care, just come, I'll wash you up. And when I was thinking about, you know, the godly man, I was like, a lot of Christians, like young Christians in this day and age, they suffer it. So like, what is the root of the problem? And these are the things that, you know, God showed me about myself and about, like, you know, all of us in general, which I want to just talk to you guys about. What do you read? What do you listen to? Who do you talk to? And, you know, I thought about it for a while. I was like, how am I going to talk about this? Because it's a really touchy topic. And you know what? To be honest, I'm not going to hold back. Whatever God puts in my heart, I'm going to say. What do you read? What kind of books do you read? We are young, and the devil will try everything to come and play with our emotions. Well, like, we are Christians. We are striving to be like Jesus. And there are some things that Jesus didn't do just for him to be that perfect lamb to be sacrificed. So, my dear, we need to drop some things that we read. Some things really entice us. And to be honest, you know who you are. Like, personally, I have to tell myself, see, this is your weak point. So you need to drop some things. You need to drop some things so that the devil cannot use those things to get into your mind. Like, what exactly do you read? Yeah, a lot of people right now are very eloquent and really nice in the way they write. But, like, do their writings edify you? Or is it just about sex and about, you know, things that, oh, do you get? And this life, this world is actually it's actually wonderful, to be honest, because people are so descriptive in their writing that they will explain everything that's happening, do you get, in their book, and you just be there imagining your head. Just like, basically, you form the movie in your head. Like, to be honest, let us try and take it back to where it all started. The Bible in Joshua 1, it says, this book of the law shall not depart from you, but it shall meditate on it day and night. Let's try and scale, make a scale. How high is the scale of when you read your Bible, and how high is the scale of when you read like other silly books? Like, I'm not even talking about your school books now. I'm just talking about like other literature that don't really make sense. Like, you get how much time do you spend reading your Bible, and how much time do you spend reading some silly books that don't edify you? And I might be saying that, and you'll be like, oh, it's not that deep. But to be honest, be honest with yourself. I think that's the first step. Be honest with yourself. What do you read? What do you read? And even when you have these thoughts, like, who do you go to first? Who are you talking to? Are you talking to that friend that will tell you, oh my God, it's well, calm down. It happens to everybody. Where, you know, this is the age where we are at our prime. Shut up. Don't say that. Daniel was young, but he decided in his heart that he will not defile himself. Guys, like, let's be real with ourselves. Daniel decided he will not defile himself. Who are we talking to? Do you have mentors in Christ that will advise you on what to do properly? Do you understand me? Who are our friends? We think that it's not that important, but to be honest, sometimes your friends have a huge influence in your life. And I hear when people say, oh, I've dropped that friend. And I'm just like, wow, I'm proud of you, because I understand that it's very hard. It is the hardest thing to do as a teenager, people that you've grown up with. But then you realize that for you to grow spiritually, you have to drop them. It is hard. It's actually hard. I know God is telling me some people right now that I need to drop. I'm just like, I've known them for too long. But it's something I have to do. To be honest, like, ask for God to help you. Like, He is there. God is that shoulder. Cry. Do you guys see? I'm not joking. When you drop those friends, you cry. Because sometimes the conversations we have with some friends don't really edify us. We're either lusting over a boy, you're lusting over a girl's body. Do you get what I'm talking about? Like, I remember in one verse, where is it? In Matthew 5:28, when I saw it, guys, I was scared. Because in Matthew 5:28, it says, "But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart." So it's just like, you don't even need to do the physical act, my dear. Like, it's already a sin. And I feel like we need to understand the power that we have in God and the Holy Spirit, that we can ourselves tell the devil to move. Because this same devil is a person that tempted our Lord Jesus Christ, and Jesus was giving him back with the word of God. Like, I always remind my friends, let's go back to our Bibles. Let's read our Bibles, because a lot of the questions that we ask, the answers are in the Bible. And because we don't read our Bibles, we start asking a lot of ridiculous questions. And people are just like, girl, she read your Bible? Oh, like, we need to go back to where it all started, the Bible. Let's read our Bibles. Another thing that God also put in my heart is, what do we listen to? A lot of things you listen to, you'll be like, oh, it's just for the beat. It's a lie. Stop lying to yourself. I was once like that. Like, you'll be like, it's just the beat. But then next week, you're reciting the lyrics, and you know that, and you notice that in the lyrics, it's talking about just adoring a girl's body from her head to her toe, and, you know, it's talking about something, or talking about a boy's body. What do you listen to? And a lot of things we listen to right now don't edify us. I'm not telling you that you should go gospel music. I'm not telling you what to do, but you know the kind of music that you listen to that doesn't edify your ears. I remember one time when I was listening to some song, and me, I like to dance. I dance everywhere. But I noticed that when I was dancing to the song, I realized that I used to dance according to the words of the song. So if the girl says, move back and turn your hand, bend down, do you get? I'm like trying to be like her. And it was distorting my mind. What do you listen to? Like, do you get what I'm talking about? I heard someone say, you know, I have my playlist from when I'm feeling, you know, it's a lie. When you're feeling a bit, you know, when you're feeling, I don't know the word to use right now, but for lack of better words, horny, go to your Bible. I'm not even joking. Go to your Bible, because when you dwell on it, you start sinning, and God is not about that life. Like, let's drop it, to be honest. And when I was reading, God told me that, you know, we need to learn how to pray, because these are ways that the devil can come and attack you. Because if you notice in the Bible, when Jesus was tempted, it was when he just finished praying and fasting. So, and even the Bible talked about how, like, he had the Holy Spirit, he had the power, and he was speaking under the authority of the Holy Spirit with the word of God. Because a lot of us don't really pray, we don't really acknowledge fasting. Like, you get, we don't really want to grow. We just want to be in a youth group. We just want to be in a Bible study. We want the feeling of being among the Christian, you know, folks. But like, we're not even trying to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And when the devil sees that part, that, you know, that laziness in you, he will come to you, because you're the one that's vulnerable to him. You're the most vulnerable person to him. And the Lord is, the devil is going around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So let's understand that the devil will not stop. So we need to be alert. We need to be sober. We need to be ready. I always remind myself, I need to put on the full armor of God. And one thing that we should not neglect is the sword of the Spirit, the Bible. Because this is something that we have physically. You get some of the other things, like the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness. Some of these things is true prayer, and maybe, you know, constant communication with God. And there's a lot of, you know, things involved, but the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, is the only physical thing that we have. So let's take advantage of it. When you wake up in the morning, what do you think about? I remember how, like, the devil used to play with my emotions. I'm never joking. I used to have thoughts about people close to me dying. I told, you know, somebody in the church, my pastor's wife, see the prayer we prayed. She said, Ogochukwu, do not stop praying. Because now that he's seen that you're scared, he will attack you more. So when you now stand up and say, excuse me, my body, my mind, everything about me is the Lord's. I'm the temple of the Lord. And anybody that wants to destroy the temple of the Lord, God will destroy him. It's in the Bible. Speak the word of God to the devil. When he sees that, you know, you're on fire, he'll step back. I'm not saying that he will not come again, but he'll step back. And when he steps back, start, you know, renewing yourself in the word. Start renewing yourself as it continue. We should not stop. I'm not even joking. Like, this past week, it was a struggle to read my Bible. But do you know why I'm so happy? It's because despite the struggle, I read my Bible. It's funny, but it was a struggle. Like, I woke up in the morning, I see my Bible beside me. I'm just like, but I read my Bible. And every day I read my Bible, God showed me something new. So guys, let's not neglect the word of God. Because it's when you're outside the word of God, the devil now comes into your head and be like, you're a failure. You're a sinner. You're a this. You're a that. You're a dirty girl. See your mind. See what you're thinking about. You're a dirty boy. It's a lie. Anyone that is in Christ is a new creation. All things are passed away. Tell the devil, you are my past. Lust is my past. Pornography is my past. All those things are my past. Do you understand me? Do not dwell in self-condemnation. That's what a lot of young Christians are like living in. And to be honest, I'm actually going to revisit this topic again, because it's deeper than it seems. But I want to just encourage us to go back to the Bible. And I think one thing I learned from somebody in one Bible study that I have is that I think she was going through a lot, and then she was like, you know what, I'm going to go through like a 30 days detox off social media, off some kind of music I listen to, off the game, just to renew your mind. And you will notice that when you come out on that like detox time, you see that your desires will change. Like, because all you're doing, you're not listening to, like, as if she blocked music. So all you do is listen to maybe messages, read your Bible, like you get Christian music. You notice that when you come out, you'll be like, you start filtering the things you listen to, people you talk to, like books you read. It's power. It's like taking yourself through those 40 days that Jesus went in the wilderness. Yes, you're like, oh, Jesus is God, you know, he could have done it. It's a lie. Jesus came in the human form so that we can follow his steps. He basically came and walked on grass and said, oh yeah, walk. That's the way, walk. So let's not try and give excuses. The Bible says, be holy, for I am holy. So that means it is possible to be holy. Because I hear a lot of people saying things like, oh, we can't be perfect like God. Mm-mm. If God has said, be holy, for I am holy, then I think, like, let's start striving for it. Yeah, you will not wake up one morning and you'll be holy. Definitely not. But are you striving for it? Are you working for it? And also, you know, when I said prayer, when I mean prayer, I mean like dedicate time out to pray for you, as in pray for yourself. Pray. Let me open a passage that, you know, I saw, and it says, 2 Corinthians 10:3-5, it says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war against the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So this passage, when I read, I was like, that means when you decide to pray for all these strongholds in your life that are trying to bring you down, are trying to hinder your spiritual growth, even the verse says we walk in the flesh, but we're not warring against the flesh. So that means the war you're going to fight is going to be spiritual warfare. So you have to, as in, take time out and pray. God, my mind is a problem right now. I can't concentrate. I can't get my head straight. Lord Jesus, help me. To be honest, how do we pray? Are we like, God, I'm about to start my day. Help me. In Jesus' name, amen. We need to take like our prayer life seriously. We need to take our prayer life seriously. And like, I just want to let you know that because you are a Christian, because you're in a Bible study or you go to church, doesn't mean the devil will not attack you. You're not different from Jesus. The devil is going to attack you. He's going to try to tempt you. It is how you respond to his temptation that really matters. So that's basically what has been in my heart for a while now, and it's what like God has been teaching me, you know, he's been pruning me daily. And I just want to share with you guys how you know, you can talk to God about these things. Like, to be honest, like where I come from, they don't really talk about these things in like youth church. They're just like, you know, God loves you and everything. But let's understand that these are things that like a lot of young Christians are going through, and like it can potentially hinder someone's spiritual growth. It's actually that important. And I'm just encouraging you guys that God understands, because like in the Bible says that we have a high priest like that basically understands what we are going through. It's Hebrews 4:15-16. Let me not paraphrase, let me read it properly. It says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all point tempted as we were, yet without sin. So let's go to him, let's go to his throne of grace and just ask him to help us. Because to be honest, like, he's the only way, he's the way, the truth and the life. And let's not try and think that we can do it by our own strength. We actually can't, because the devil wants to steal, kill and destroy, and we cannot let him. As youth of this generation, I always tell my friend, our generation shall praise God's name. If you don't want to praise God's name, you can scoot, but my generation is going to praise God's name, and the devil is not going to hold us down. He will never hold us down. But just to encourage you guys to dwell on the word of God, speak to God like he's your father. Even if you don't want to say in Jesus' name, say, Daddy, I need you. God, I need you. Like me, what I do is I talk to myself. I won't say I talk to myself, but I just talk to God. I'm just like, God, please, like, I'm just talking. And sometimes people are just like, is this girl crazy? Like, don't care about what people think about you. It's your personal battle. And I'll just give you guys scriptures to just dwell upon, like Philippians 4:6. I won't have to my wall here. It says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, noble, true, just, pure, lovely, of good report, if there's any virtue, or if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Guys, let's watch the kind of things we listen to our company. Psalm 1:1 says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, nor stands in the way of sinners, but his delight is in the word of the Lord. Let's watch the kind of company we keep. You think it's not important? To God, it's important. It's important. If in the Bible it says, blessed is he who does not, you know, stand with these kind of people. So let's be serious when it comes to our relationship with God. And I just pray that God will just keep on strengthening us as he youths, and he will keep on upholding us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And yes, God bless you guys. Bye. That's what it said.